Okay, so I'm on to chapter 3 of Jacques Ellul's The Technological Society. And I think probably the biggest takeaway from this chapter, which is entitled Technique and the Economy, is his point that there's not nearly as much space between capitalism and communism, or what he calls the corporate economy and the planned economy, as people would like to think. He is quite adamant that both of them are more similar than they are different on the most fundamental thing, namely their relationship to technique. Now, I like to say that capitalism and communism are two branches off of the Enlightenment tree. So this idea is not totally new to me. In both cases, you get the materialism that was one aspect of some of the thinking in the Enlightenment. You get this notion that human beings can create a sort of optimized world based upon their own reason and their own productivity. You get a consequent sort of diminution of the spiritual side of life. You get, of course, materialism with this dream of material abundance in both cases. And there's this, of course, this notion that people are equal, although they differ as to where the equality really matters, whether it's equality of legal equality and opportunity or whether it's actual material equality. Another interesting takeaway is that Ellul at this time seemed to think that the planned economy would prevail, that is the communist or socialist type of economy would prevail, simply because it was easier for technique to work with it, so to speak, that technique thwarted the goals of capitalism more than it did communism, because capitalists would find it unprofitable the rate at which technique would grow and develop new means of doing things and changing things. The capitalism needed a certain amount of stability in both machinery and means in order for capitalists to make a profit, whereas communist economic planners could just continually they could change at a more rapid rate the techniques used, because they wouldn't be trying to turn a profit. I think it's an open question as to whether Ellul's right about that one, but we're dealing with hindsight now. Remember that this was written in the 50s, and so communism looked like a real competitor to capitalism at that point, and people were scared of it. But of course, in hindsight, it was corporatism, you might say, or the rule of corporations, which was more powerful, and which now the former Soviet Union and China have both actually adopted. I suppose Ellul would have been surprised by that, but he'd see technique at work in all areas. It's just that the system that he thought was weaker turned out to be stronger, at least in the short run. And even though he was pretty prophetic about it, I don't think he could possibly have foreseen just how much planning and collusion could be done within a free, so-called free market economy. But I wanted to get right to this one quote. This is on my page 186, where Ellul compares the corporate and the planned economy. That's the capitalist and the communist or socialist type of economy. And he makes several points where he believes there's a lot of kinship between the two. He says, from this point of view, the corporate economy and the planned economy come singularly close together to the degree that both systems, A, take a firm hold on the economy, B, manage it on the basis of exact mathematical methods, C, integrate it into a Promethean society which excludes all chance, D, centralize it in the frameworks of nation and state. The corporate economy today has no chance of success except as a state system. E, cause it to assume an aspect of formal democracy to the total exclusion of real democracy. And F, exploit all possible techniques for controlling men. The kinship of the two systems is obvious in spite of differences in material structure. So these points go well beyond the point I made above about the twin branches off the same Enlightenment tree. Notice that he says that even in the so-called corporate or capitalist economy, the government takes a firm hold of the economy and manages it on the basis of exact mathematical methods. And he has previously gone into how government, you know, uses the experts that are produced by the universities, which of course are heavily subsidized by the government, to manage the economy to the favor of the of corporations and businesses, and also to manage the citizenry. And of course, corporations use the same statisticians and other experts to figure out how to what to make and how to create demand for it. So that's what he means by managing it on the basis of exact mathematical methods. And here's the thing. In the United States in particular, I think that we tend to want to think that the economy that we have is a free economy. But if you take a closer look at it, it is by no means a free economy. The government is all over it. Probably the starkest example would just be the 2008-ish downturn in the economy, the Great Recession that we had, in which huge amounts of monetary machinations were done in order to save as many of the corporations and therefore as many jobs as possible, right? I think I mentioned in one of the last couple of videos the quantitative easing, which just went on and on and on, basically, you know, printing money, making it possible to borrow from the Fed for basically free in an attempt to stimulate the economy. And, you know, there were direct bailouts of some corporations. But in addition to that, the government creates the infrastructure. It produces the people. I mean, you have the people who are employed, you have them being shaped from the time they're in grade school all the way through their university education to be good workers. You have all of the different expertise that's created in those institutions that's funneled into both government and corporations. You have tax policy, you have social welfare programs to cushion the blow of downturns in the economy. You have employment and unemployment programs. You've got all kinds of ways that the government cooperates with corporate employers and in basically making it possible for people to deal with the vagaries of the economy. And you have a great deal of government support in direct subsidization of certain industries, in particular agriculture. I've sat through a hearing or two on federal government ag policy, and I'm here to tell you that there's so much government all over farming in this country that it couldn't possibly be done in the way we do it without that much government interference. So there's a sector of our economy which is heavily regulated and controlled. Notice that he also says that we have in the capitalist system formal democracy but not real democracy. So what he means by real democracy, I suppose, is, you know, people being more or less able to accomplish changes to more fundamental changes to the way things are done than they're able to do through their vote. They can affect policy to a certain extent by electing Republicans versus Democrats in the United States or similar parties in other countries. But beyond a certain point, they cannot. And so I think this is what he means by real democracy, be real rule by the people, which would mean a different set of priorities, that the people might not want to be low-paid worker bees in the corporate structure. And that last statement he makes about both corporate and planned economies exploit all possible techniques for controlling men. Well, again, it's easier to see in a communist country how this is done through propaganda, but Ellul makes the argument, and we saw a little bit of this last time, he makes the argument that there's a whole lot of propaganda all around, that everything that's said by politicians, by a lot of members of the media, tends to basically uphold the status quo. Now, you may think that they're arguing, but from the perspective of somebody like Ellul, there just isn't that much difference between Republicans and Democrats and, you know, between, say, Fox News and CNN. You know, they all support not only the capitalist economy in the case of the capitalist economy, but also they support the whole legitimacy of the system, that the notion that the parties, the various political parties and movements, are effective and can get things done. Another interesting thing he points out in this chapter is that technique's growth inevitably creates a sort of cognoscenti, that is a sort of class that is in the know, an intellectual elite. And no matter if we're talking about liberal democracy or communist people's democracy, the existence of the cognoscenti is a contradiction to democracy. Statisticians of all kinds and in all places, in business and in government, along with their partners in areas like anthropology, sociology, psychology, political science, they're more and more the so-called secret society. I do believe Ellul, uses that term, secret society, that's actually running things. Now, that may sound a little conspiratorial the way I just said it, but actually, he's just talking about the fact that more and more we turn to the expert in every single area to make the decision. And the citizen is left with the choice of what expert to listen to, perhaps, or, you know, the government leader can hire whatever experts he wants. But more and more, we don't think for ourselves, we rely upon experts. And so they are the ones who are truly in charge, because they have the knowledge, which we have, we've ceded our control to the power of that knowledge. Then he goes on to say that in order for statisticians and other experts to do their job efficiently, they have to view human beings as a mass. They naturally do. They don't study the individual. They don't recommend policies and procedures or products on the basis of the individual. It's what people are like as a whole that's necessary to know about. And so that's where their techniques are applied. Well, this is what Ellul calls massification, the turning of the people into the masses. And he says it's encouraged by both corporate and government power so that the private and public statisticians can do their job and everything will run smoothly. He says, quote, "The system works all the better when it deals with men who are better integrated into the mass, men whose consciousness is partially paralyzed, who lend themselves willingly to statistical observations and systemization. The results obtained by this technique are impressive, even though the technique is still immature," end quote. And I must say, I don't think it's still immature. That was back in the 50s, but surely that we can see that government and corporate techniques to more or less manipulate people and turn them into the masses, which can be governed and sold to and employed, has come a long, long, long way. He spends a little time on the relationship between the state and academia. He says, quote, "If the state is to pay for statistical research, it must get something in return, assistance in directing national affairs. The state requires the economist, on the basis of statistics, to seek out methods of intervention, either directly or by subtle means, such as those advocated by John Maynard Keynes." So you may be aware there's this debate that's been going on in our country for quite some time. It's mainly been, I think, won in recent years from by the supply side part of the debate, but the debate between Keynesian economics and the so-called supply side or trickle-down economics policy. And the Keynesian economics was about, as I understand it, creating full employment by stimulating the economy from below, from by whatever means, getting more money into the hands of people most likely to spend it. Whereas trickle-down economics was and is more about helping the big businesses and corporations to keep as much of their money as possible, so tax cuts, so that they will expand and employ more people is the idea, and the economy will expand. What's interesting about this mention by Ellul is that I don't think that he would really think, again, that there was that much of a difference, because stepping back and looking at these from the point of view of technique, both Keynesian economics and supply side economics are driven by technique. First of all, they are a type of technique. But secondly, they are about creating consumption. They're about creating customers. And the question then is, what's the better way to do it? Well, if what your policy is about stimulating the economy and creating more demand, more things bought, then Ellul's point is you have just served technique, because technique makes things that people don't really, many things that people don't really need, that demand has to occur in order for them to be bought, basically, and to continue to grow the economy. But we might ask ourselves if we really need to continually grow the economy, and we might even radically ask ourselves if people really need to be fully employed. That is, do we have to work at least 40 hours a week, or does everybody have to do that if we don't have to have all the things that we're told we need to have? I know that sounds convoluted, but there's this, you know, there's this assumption deeply ingrained in our political rhetoric on both sides, as well as in our media on all the different sides that they represent, that full employment and an ever-growing economy is a good thing. And yet, you know, who enjoys working 40 to 60 hours a week, and particularly who enjoys, you know, what many folks are going through right now, working two or three jobs and working far more than 40 hours a week just trying to get by? Now, Ellul seemed to think that communism would win the competition. Back then in the Cold War, it looked like communism was winning for a while, and people were pretty frightened by it. And I think that he thought that technique would be better served by communists, because he explains that capitalists sometimes get ruined by technique. You know, that the advancements in various both mechanical and behavioral techniques outstrip the capitalist's ability to actually change and to change with profitability. And so it puts some of them out of business. And it doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to make more money, or that they're going to create the conditions where more money can be made in the future. Whereas the communists don't have to worry about making a profit. They can change things up whenever they want to. But as we know, even most of the communist countries have moved towards capitalism. And it would seem that, at least in the short run, as for now, capitalism won this. Doesn't mean that Ellul is wrong about capitalism being very planned. And in fact, I suppose part of the way that it might have won it, so to speak, is by becoming much more planned and much less free than it was. So I think I'll just leave you with this quote. which kind of follows up on what I just said. He says, technique is inevitably opposed to the liberal economy because the end of technique is efficiency and rationality, and the end of liberalism is profit, money profit. Technique requires of the liberal economy non-profitable decisions and risks. For example, when expensive new machines are developed before the old ones have been amortized, the industrialist is forced to liquidate old machines or he runs the risk of being eliminated from the market. So that kind of backs up the point I just made. He also says that the capitalist economy is also anti-democratic because the expert takes over, and so while people still vote, economic policy and planning outcomes are largely beyond their control. And while they get standardized and often more plentiful goods, they have no real power over what goods they get. The public, for instance, he says, did not demand air travel. Air travel possibilities created demand. And most fundamentally, it's anti-democratic because, quote, economic man and, quote, statistical man replaces political man. That's a lot of mans. But what he means is yourself as a political person, as a citizen, it becomes diminished. And, you know, hence so much apathy and lack of interest in even voting, or disbelief that voting can matter. And, you know, because what takes over is your economic desires and behavior and your, you know, need to make money. And you're manipulated by government and by corporations as statistical man through what he calls propaganda. I guess we could call it, in the case of the economy, advertising. Anyway, that probably gets the heart of the chapter out. They're big, long chapters, but hopefully that's enough to give you an idea of what this chapter's about. See you next time for chapter 4. And there's a total of 6 chapters in this book. All right, bye.